What's up, people? How have you been? Welcome back to Interview with Abhimanyu. Please subscribe to our channel and press the bell icon because you don't want to miss out on the brilliant stuff that we bring every single week. My guest today is a very interesting dude. He is a stargazer who runs a company called Beyond Earth. Now, Beyond Earth takes people from the dense concrete jungles of the city to the outskirts of Mumbai and makes them see stars. And even a galaxy if you're lucky enough. Now here's the best part. He's also a fiction writer who has written a book called 14,000 and Above. Now let me tell you what happens when two fiction writers sit together. We bitch about the world. In the conversation, we did some Game of Thrones predictions. We spoke about the art of writing. We spoke about the future of books and of Netflix. We discussed the current trends in social media, like what's happening in Instagram, Facebook, YouTube, and TikTok. We spoke about space. All in all, it was a brilliant conversation. It was like a story. When you watch the video or listen to the audio, you'll feel like you're turning the pages of a book. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome my guest all the way from Mumbai, the brilliant Vikram Virulkar.
Listen to it when you're sleeping, it'll make you smarter.
I hate it when I have to do this without Karen. Welcome to the show, bro.
Thank you
for, you know, ये छोटा ट्रिप करने के लिए फॉर दिस डिटोर आई रियली अप्रिशिएट इट एंड या वी वर बिफोर वी स्टार्टेड वी टॉकिंग अबाउट डेक्सटर वी विल कम टू दैट अगेन बट टेल मी पूना सो यू कम फ्रॉम बॉम्बे विल यू एवर चूज पूना ओवर बॉम्बे आई आस्क दिस क्वेश्चन टू एवरी मुंबई कर आई डोंट नो व्हाई दो आई नो द आंसर एवरीवन हैज द सेम आंसर बट विल यू एवर
इट डिपेंड्स
ओके
द वे करंट सिचुएशन इज गोइंग नो
No?
No, I'm too much in love with Mumbai to ever let it go.
The pace of life?
The pace of life, the sights and the sounds, the memories that I've made there. I come from a forces family.
Right.
So my dad was a wing commander in the Air Force.
Yeah.
And his last posting was at Thane. And my mom was a teacher.
Uh-huh.
And she used to work in Mahim.
Okay.
So that's why dad said, you know, last posting... usually, I think the way it goes is that usually the last posting, the officers do get a choice of where do you want to retire to.
Okay.
So, dad thought, you know, my wife's working and boy's working in Mumbai, so let me just, you know, get a place here rather than anywhere else. Most of my family is from Indore.
Indore.
And we had a house also for some time there.
Okay.
But now we've come back to Mumbai. My mom stayed in Mumbai all her life.
Right.
Yeah, so once that happened, we were together.
Because whoever I have spoken to, so the moment I say Mumbai or Pune, before I end now, so they are like, Mumbai man, what are you doing? What are you doing? But I also know a few people who are willing because they say that it's getting on their heads now, the whole...
Yeah. I know where they're coming from.
Yeah, exactly.
Because the daily struggle
yeah.
of getting from point A to point B.
That's the point here.
Yeah, it is just too harrowing. So one of my friends, I stay in Borivali. One of my friends works in Bandra, which is not very far.
Okay.
Not very far. And he uses a car to go to work.
Right.
And
very
bad choice.
Yeah.
And every day he spends upwards of, I think, 4 hours.
That is
trapped
insane.
In that car.
That is like almost 80 days in 1 year.
Exactly.
In a car.
It is. He is inside the car.
Yeah.
So now they carpool.
Mm.
And, you know... Mukesh Ambani ki wajah se Jio aa gaya. So they pull up the screens, they watch a movie, they do whatever they have to
yeah.
do, and they sit in the car and they take turns. Main gaadi chalaunga, tu gaadi chalayega, parso ye gaadi chalayega, and all that. Plus with the metro work that is going on, it is just a nightmare.
Yeah. So I've stayed in Delhi, and I stayed in Delhi when metro ban raha tha, Commonwealth time pe, jab Commonwealth shuru hua tha. So I have felt the heat, you know, metros ka ki kya hota hai, wo banti nahi, aisa lagta hai, endless hai, wo bas wo boards lag jate hain, sign boards, aur uske baad wo waise hi rehte hain.
You just want people to say stop, jitna ho gaya, utna chhod do, please take all the scaffolding off, I need
exactly.
to get to work, or I need to come back to work.
The roads get, you know, narrower, and I don't know, fir
wo the roads get narrower, and on top of it, the trains are nowhere.
Yeah.
I mean, in my book, I've actually written.
You're talking about 14,000 and above.
14,000 and above.
Yeah.
So I've mentioned two places which I sort of have a love-hate relationship.
Uh-huh.
There's one place called Dadar. In
right.
Mumbai.
Hmm.
Okay. So I wrote something to the effect of, you know, it's called Dadar Station, but it has another name in my vocabulary, which is a black hole.
Okay.
Where, you know, the laws of space-time break
yeah,
down.
Yeah.
Things don't make any sense.
Right.
The number of people who climbed in can be inversely proportional to the number of people climbing out, or the desire to get home in one piece. Okay, the stronger your desire is, okay, the more people will barge in the train. More people will do that. You've seen that famous meme, "Dar ke aage jeet hai, daadar ke aage
jeet hai."
So it is ridiculous in that fashion. But it's again centrally connected, and I've got a lot of memories connected to Dadar and places like that. So, theek hai, once a Mumbaikar gets going, okay, there's usually very little things that can slow him down. Okay, so he knows he has to go to work.
Right.
He knows he has to, you know, do this job, or he knows he has to come back home.
Yeah.
And there is no other option.
Exactly. You have to love it.
You have to love it.
Yeah.
There is no other option. Jaisa bhi hai, aisa. So during my college days, I used to go to Elphinstone College, which is in Churchgate.
Right.
So there's one solace that I used to get in the train from Borivali and get down in Churchgate. So there are two endpoints. But a variety of things used to happen. So people, I'm not sure if... I'm not sure if you know this, but there's a phenomenon called bhajan mandals.
Bhajan mandal.
Yeah. So what will happen is a group of people will come together. They always have a fixed place of sitting. Okay. Their group will come together. As soon as the train starts, they'll bring out this symbol, small, what do you call them? The one that you...
I don't know.
I forget the
brass thing that you bang into each other.
So... they'll start that.
Hmm.
As soon as the train starts, and once they get down, okay, that is when the sound will stop.
Right.
And they keep singing bhajans all the way.
Right.
Okay. So some people find it very entertaining. Some people find it extremely irritating.
Right.
Me, as long as you have some of your headphones on, doesn't really make a difference.
Yeah.
But yeah, every day you do get a free massage coming home or going to work. So that's, I think, steam massage.
Awesome. You would say. Right. So, Vikram, I think your project that you're doing called Beyond Earth, I think it's crazy. I personally think it's really crazy, and I really want to talk about everything that you do. But for the first time is show pe, I have, you know, a bro from the same craft, writer. So I really want to talk about writing before let's just fucking talk about writing. So what do you think is happening right now? Where is it going? What do you think the writers need to do? You know, your advice for people like, you know, us and everyone who wants to write.
I think it's very difficult for me to say what writers should do. You've obviously heard the term, you know, become a philosopher, but make sure you get rich first.
Nobody's going to give a shit then.
Yeah. So I'm not at that place in my life where I think it is okay for me to dispense advice upon people who are writing or doing that. My first book came out because of a multitude of reasons. I always knew in some way that I wanted to become a writer.
When was that?
I was very young. One of the reasons I started getting into reading at all was Robinson Crusoe.
Okay.
Okay. So Robinson Crusoe, written by Daniel Defoe.
Yeah.
So he was the first, I think, recorded novelist. Also this week.
No, I had no idea about
that.
Okay.
So he was one of the first recorded novelists who wrote Robinson Crusoe, which was based upon a true story at some point. It's a fantastic book.
Okay.
And I used to always feel a little different from the world. I was always feeling, kuch to alag hai. I'm not enjoying this so much. I'm sort of an introvert. Okay. Robinson Crusoe came up and it told the story about this man who is shipwrecked.
Okay.
For 24 years.
Right.
And he stays alone on the island. He has all this time to think about stuff and everything. So I kind of related to his character a lot. Because I used to feel isolated a lot. I used to feel, you know, not... I won't say not included, because I never made an effort to sort of...
The way introverts are.
So that really pushed me. After that, I really got into the classics.
Okay.
I didn't read... I still haven't read, believe it or not, the Harry Potter books.
Okay. I have.
I haven't.
Like a maniac,
And most people keep calling me out because how can you as a writer not read the Harry Potter
books? I'll tell you something that people tell me, but yeah, I'll let you finish.
Yeah. So, once I started reading, you know, Robinson Crusoe, then I went on to Charles Dickens, then I started getting enamored with Shakespeare, then I started getting enamored with all these things. Then I knew that, you know, mere bhi andar koi story hogi, jo mujhe batana hai logon.
Right.
And I think all writers have, through their stories, told a mixture of fiction plus some part of their own life.
A major part of
their own life. So every story is sort of an autobiography in some sort or the other. You'll always find one aspect of the writer's soul in there.
Especially the first one.
So I made a lot of effort into writing the first one. And one of my friends, one of my very good friends, whom I met actually through my stargazing and everything.
Okay.
So she sort of started, you know, I was going nowhere with it.
Right.
And, you know, she said, what do you do? Like, I write. I used to write for websites and about space and all of those things. Lacha, what have you written? Show. So I showed her. She said, yeah, bro, this is a good book. Why don't you keep, you know, on the same path? So it became sort of a project. After every 2-3 chapters, I would send it to her.
Right.
And then she would read it and then she would say, acha, you've ended it at a cliffhanger again. So, you know, when's the next part coming?
Exactly.
In somewhere in the middle, I sent it across to publishers, as the norm is. And
the response must be obvious, right?
Yeah, no response.
Yeah.
No response at all. Zero.
Hate them.
Okay. So one of them suddenly replied back, and I was over the moon. I said, response. And they said that, you know, we'll publish your book, but we won't get behind on. We can't offer you the other stuff like marketing and everything because, you know, we have to go according to what the trends are and everything. So, for example, if romance is doing very well, so they'll concentrate on romance and
I know. Right now, for example, they're concentrating on stories that'll end up being Netflix shows. That's what they're doing.
So, it's a potential, like, end of the road type
game.
So, I said, fine. How hard can it be? So,
best part of the conversation. Really decide over.
How hard can it be to get, you know, people to read my book?
Very hard.
So, they gave me a deadline, said, you know, this is the time. You need to submit your manuscript by that time. And you need to sort of get behind on your book and start publicizing it and start doing it and everything. So, I was never a marketing guy. I was a sales guy because I did sales for some time. So I knew if I sit with someone, I'll sell him the product, whatever it is. But how do I convince thousands of people that I've never met, who have never seen my face, who have no idea that I'm a writer, or even if I am a writer, is my book worth reading? Because any book will be worth at least 5-7 hours of somebody's time, which can be better spent on Instagram or Facebook.
Exactly.
So I tried to get behind that. And that is probably in the midst of when we met last year.
Yeah, last year.
Which, as I said, is a coincidence that today is
1 year.
One year to the day that we actually
the
met.
The book fest, right?
Yeah. So, crazy. So, I came up to the fest, you know, started talking to people about the book and everything.
Right.
And some people did show interest because I was there in front of them. Okay. And after that, a few personal setbacks happened, and I was no longer in the mind space to sort of market it or promote it, and it died a little sorry death. So people who read the book said, you know, wow, it is fantastic. We've never read something like this happen in the paradigm of Indian fiction, because I think a lot of our fiction is a lot like our movies. It's saturated with romance, and I can't write romance. Which is very tough.
I tried to be real. I don't know how to write romance. I think I call it a flaw or whatever. I think when you try to write romance, you're faking it.
Somewhat, yeah.
Yeah. So if you are writing romance, you just, if you have experienced it, right? So you just write whatever you experience.
Yeah.
I think it ends up being romance. That's what
I think. It ends up being romance and...
To some.
Plus a lot of writers sort of have that kind of mind for that. Which is a big plus.
Is
a big plus.
It's a fingerprint, man.
It's a fingerprint.
Yeah.
You can't really help it.
Exactly.
You think the way you think. So I don't think particularly in romance terms.
Right.
Okay. So that is why some of my stories end up becoming really, really odd and awkward if somebody would have been placed in that situation. Just case in point. So after 14,000 and above was done.
Right.
So I started writing another book later on, which is called. The letter R.
The letter R.
The letter R.
The book is called.
The book is called The Letter R, which I'm in the process of writing.
Yeah.
And the premise of the story was that this guy goes through a very rough patch throughout his life, and every time that he encounters people with the name of the letter R.
Okay. Nice.
So he has been through, I think, 6-7 dumpings. All of the girls that he's been dumped.
I can totally fucking relate to it because I have a thing, SH. So people who have SH.
The letter
in their
R is actually a, how should I say? It's a throw off for another letter from my life.
I somehow figured that you aren't being direct.
Yeah, I mean, I can't be direct because people go to my Facebook and, you know, check
everything
out.
Just say it, man. I just said it as such. Many people are like, "Achha, main bhi hoon."
So later on I came and I thought this is an original idea.
Uh-huh.
Okay. And that's, I think we just talked about this before the interview starts, that you figure out that your book is just one book among X number of books. And later on, I came across John Green's book, An Abundance of Catherines.
Never read it, yeah.
Okay. Mm. So he talks about the same thing.
Okay.
So An Abundance of Catherines is about something in the line of every breakup he has ever gone through, and everybody that has given him emotional trauma has the name Catherine.
Okay,
I've not read the book.
I know about the book.
So that's how basically it goes on. And I started writing the book and I discovered, you know, yaar, what ganda romance ke hai maine sabhi. So some of it felt like, you know, I'm one of those, I won't go to the extent of calling me the Indian on, you know, you've got these Saint Bob and Vagin
people. You know, my first guest told me about this. Behind the scenes, that people get these texts that send. I like, what Bob?
What
Bob are you talking about? Tell me Bob. And then I'm like, Bob.
Bob. Okay, so I won't go.
They're asking for boobs, right?
Yeah, they are. And you know, I've realized that I've talked to so many girls, I've talked to so many women, and everybody's done that, and they just don't know how to talk to girls.
Yeah, they don't.
They don't know how to talk to girls, especially if you come from a background where you don't have, like, one of the things that I, one of the reasons for my social awkwardness towards girls was that I grew up in an all-boys school.
Okay.
Okay. And there was this, it was a convent school, and we were very strictly regulated to do a lot of things.
Okay.
Okay. And forget the fact that, you know, we ended up becoming one of the most mischievous classes to ever pass out from that institution, but we never met girls, or I never interacted with them. So when I came to college for the first time, I was like, itni sari kahan se aayi hai? So slowly, you know, as friendships were made and all these things were done, so I understood how to, you know, talk to girls, or how to not be socially awkward amongst, you know.
Okay, I don't think there's a way.
There isn't a way. The
That's
way is,
exactly.
It's just how you treat everybody else.
Exactly. So
but
the moment
thing,
you think that there's a way and you start practicing it,
yeah.
I think that's where you mess it up. Maybe. Because then you show your true color, that how are you going to practice it?
How
someone is
going
to be like...
No, I think it's more of the reason why all these... One of my theories is why, you know, these kind of people exist is because they've never had that conversation.
Right.
Okay. They've always been under, you know, tum ladke ho, tum ladkiyon se baat mat karo, ya tum ladkiyan ho, tum ladkon se baat mat. And it still goes on.
Yeah.
Not maybe not in a Mumbai,
no,
Pune, Delhi.
It's a prevalent thing.
It's a prevalent thing in our country.
Right.
Or any desi country for that matter. So, once I started going through the motions, I started looking at, you know, girls, achha ye achhi lagi mujhe, ya phir, you know, this girl is really pretty. And then I started realizing ki achha, girls bhi aisa karti hai. Not in a very subtle way, not like the boys do it, but the girls also think about guys, the girls also, you know, do all those things, but they aren't overtly open about it or anything of the sort. So that's how my idea of romance came across, and, you know, I've tried to write in the book as in the case that, you know, how he grows from every sort of, how he is severely immature at first, then he starts becoming a little more serious, starts understanding these women a little better, starts understanding ki achha, you know, this is why the breakup happened, or this is why it happened. But ultimately it comes up back to that R.
R,
ki wo jitna bhi hota hai, and I don't want to give too much of it away, so that's how the book goes on. So all these things, I think every writer has to discover for himself. Nobody can tell you the right way to write a book. Because every time somebody tries, one, they make an industry out of it,
mm.
and two, they fail horribly.
Mm.
Okay, so the only sort of pet peeve that I have these days is that please don't write in two sentences.
I know where you're going. Yeah.
Okay, please don't write in two sentences. Especially these, I don't want to generalize or anything, but especially these shared posts, she was like wildfire, she blew away the first.
Yeah.
Why are you talking about some random person in third person?
Like, this is, you know, the most famous, but she writes long poems as well. Rupi Kaur, right?
Mm-hmm.
So she has all. So, you know what? What's my take on this,
mm-hmm.
the writing thing? I'll tell you what I feel about it. Are you ready for this?
Yeah, sure.
I think books are dead. For people like you and me, it's so, you know what? And I don't blame people for that. I just think it's pure evolution. Why? I'll tell you.
Mm-hmm.
I really feel it. Books are dead because, you know, let's just talk about the reason why people
mm-hmm.
used to read books. Curiosity,
right.
And you know, they were seeking knowledge. One. Second, stimulation.
Yeah.
Either they were wanted to read, you know, murder, sex, violence, crime, blah, blah, blah.
Mm.
So, stimulation part, they were getting from books. People got interested. People who weren't interested, they gave it a shot. Some liked it, some left it. Now you know where stimulation is going, right?
Yeah.
How it is being catered. Like,
yes, some gratification.
So, it's like, you know, technology, the main aspect.
Yeah.
People don't realize what technology has made us all. They don't realize.
Mm.
They are being that person that I'm talking about, but they don't realize. It has turned us into, I think these, you know, we have turned into, you know, gluttonous hogs. We hum haath khol ke muh, haath phila ke muh khol ke baithe ki haan, do content, maro muh pe. Because we are waiting, aur nahi mile to withdrawal symptoms aate hain. We want it every single second.
Yeah, yeah.
Every single second. So the storytelling part, you know, it was, yes, it's the same with everything, right? It evolved radio, TV, computers, internet,
mm.
now online streaming. And you know what? I think people are bored of Netflix as well. They aren't doing anything else because they don't have an option. The moment they get an option, they're going to fuck Netflix. They're like, fuck
yeah,
it, I don't want to. And that's where they're getting their stimulation from, stories. So I don't think people will read books anymore. Tum aur mere jaise log sirf boode logon ko cater karenge. I'm not lying, like 40 above, 30 above, aise. Because people don't want to. So I just totally think books, though I know people like you and me, we aren't going to leave writing because
yeah,
that's what we do.
You can't, because
but yeah, that's sad.
It's a calling. I'm not going to go so far as to say it's a calling, but it's something that you need to do, and then you can't prevent yourself from doing it,
especially if you know the art chose you. It's like that's what happened to me. मैं 22 का था, मुझे कोई आइडिया नहीं था मैं कभी लिखूंगा क्या करूंगा. आई वाज अ लॉयर. मैं उधर जा रहा हूँ, अपनी फर्म में जा रहा हूँ, कोर्ट जा रहा हूँ, घर जा रहा हूँ, ये कर रहा हूँ दिन भर आगे पीछे. सडनली एक दिन आई एम जस्ट लाइक यू नो ऑल टीयर्स एंड ऑल मोर, मैं लिखना शुरू हो रहा हूँ. आई एंडेड अप राइटिंग अ लॉट एंड आई वाज लाइक व्हाट द फक, ये क्या. एंड इट वाजंट अ ड्राफ्ट और एनीथिंग, इट वाज अ प्लॉट, लाइक ऑलमोस्ट अ शॉर्ट स्टोरी. सो आई डिलीटेड एवरीथिंग.
ओके.
आई वाज लाइक, I didn't give two shits ki kya likha hai maine, kya nahi likha. I deleted it, and that was the answer. That was the calling, you know, hota aata divine signal. And that was when I was 22. So after that, I knew that whatever I have to do, you know, this has to be a part of it. I won't force it.
Yeah.
It's going to happen. So yeah, that we are going to write. That's the whole point. But as far as readers are concerned, as you said, instant gratification. People are really happy in these two lines.
Exactly.
They look for quotes. They want quotes. They don't realize that ek puri, even if it's a plot, right? So they want synopsis chahiye. Fatafat batao kya hua hai. Tabhi wo padhenge ya movie dekhenge ya kuch karenge. They don't understand that the real nectar, the real juice lies in the mundane conversations.
Yes.
Right?
100%.
Agar hum chahe India और किसी कंट्री की वॉर चल रही है और हम वो फतेह कर लेंगे पार्ट, लेकिन जो हम बैठ के यहाँ पे नॉर्मल बात कर रहे हैं अपनी फैमिली के बारे में, दैट इज वेयर द रियल स्टोरी इज कंस्ट्रक्टेड. सो इट्स रियली हार्ड टू कन्विंस रीडर्स दैट ओके दिस इज द थिंग, बट आई डोंट नो.
या आई थिंक यू आर राइट ऑन लॉट ऑफ थिंग्स देयर. नंबर वन इज, एज यू सेड, नेटफ्लिक्स से भी लोग बोर हो रहे हैं अभी. पीपल आर गेटिंग बोर बिकॉज यू नो वन ऑफ द रीजंस व्हाई आई रियलाइज दिस सम टाइम बैक, वन ऑफ द रीजंस व्हाई फेसबुक इज सो एडिक्टिंग, ओके, is because it does not have a stop point.
Yeah, you just keep on scrolling,
keep on scrolling,
video by video.
So, you read a book, there is a start, a definite start.
Yeah.
There is, you know, the middle where you're very invested in the story, very interested in finding out what's going to happen and everything. And by the end of the book, whether it was a good book or a bad book, made you feel happy, made you feel sad, but it's an end there.
Right.
Okay. So people derive this sense of satisfaction. And what happens is that you need that constant dopamine rush again and again and again and again.
You're talking about Facebook.
I'm talking about Facebook. Yeah. Or Insta for that matter. Yeah. Or Snap for that matter.
Anything.
And once that happens, once you've caught in that particular net, so it's more or less, again, just like any other addiction, I suppose.
Right.
Either you drink a lot or you smoke a lot or you're on drugs or whatever. So then you need to keep injecting yourself with that.
Exactly. So I was also talking to someone, I think I've said this thing before, but earlier when there was no social media, the art didn't reach people like instantly.
Mm.
The moment it is created, it's out, right? So, पहले एक आर्टिस्ट काम करता था वो उस पर साल लगा के करता था उस पर प्रेशर नहीं था कि मुझे कल कुछ और भी अपलोड करना है वो साल लगा के एक मास्टरपीस तैयार करेगा जो उसके लिए मास्टरपीस है पीपल डोंट गिव अ शिट राइट बट वो क्रिएट करेगा एंड देन ही रिलीजेस इट एंड देन आइदर ही विल गेट अप्रिसिएशन और ही विल गेट यू नो शिट पीपल से कि क्या बनाया क्या नहीं जो भी है आइदर इट्स गोना बी अ नेगेटिव थिंग और इट्स गोना बूस्ट हिज मोरल अप वो एक टाइम के बाद आएगा दिस रिवॉर्ड थिंग राइट ही हैज डन समथिंग ही विल गेट द रिवॉर्ड आफ्टर एक यू नो
आफ्टर अ पॉइंट
एग्जैक्टली वो टाइम या एग्जैक्टली वो क्रिएट करने के बाद बाहर जाने इमीडिएटली लाइक्स यू नो द करेंसी इज लाइक्स सो लाइक्स मिलना दैट गिव्स यू दैट डोपामिन किक कि हाँ क्या कर डाला भाई ने तो उसके बाद आई थिंक इट्स जस्ट रुइनिंग एंड प्लस देयर आर अ लॉट ऑफ स्टूपिड पीपल आउट देयर यू कांट डिनाई दैट सोशल मीडिया इंस्टाग्राम इट्स जस्ट दैट I don't think Instagram has made people stupid.
Were stupid. It's given them a platform.
Exactly. It has just shown people who they really are. Right?
Mm.
Yeah. कि आप चूतिया हो, आप ऐसे हो और आप चूतिया हरकतें ही करोगे वहाँ पे आके. So I don't know. Are you happy with the Instagram thing right now? You can't help it because you have to use it. It's a tool.
I do have to use Instagram.
Hmm.
I do have to use Facebook. So one of my friends, he's actually deleted Facebook and Instagram from his phone.
He'll come back.
Okay. He comes back in spurts, but he'll log into the browser and he'll sort of do it from there.
Okay.
But he won't keep that app on.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
And he said, you know, you should do the same. You should disconnect.
Right.
I said, well, I would love to, but I can't afford to.
Exactly. Especially if you're listening to people like Gary Vee.
whoever it is.
Yeah.
But I can't afford to anymore
because
I need to tell people what I'm doing.
Mm.
It's almost become sort of a routine.
Yeah.
After, I mean, even for my stargazing and everything.
That's evolution.
So I have to let people know. I'm going here. I'm going there. Join me. Kyun bhai papi pet ka mamla hai.
Yeah, exactly.
Karna padega mujhe. Nahi karunga to nahi hoga. And when this happens, when you come up to this extent, as you said, like stupid people already existed, weird people already existed.
Mm.
It's just given them a platform.
Yeah.
So the more we connect, the more we get the weapons of mass distraction out there, the more people are going to adopt it.
Right.
Now, one of the very weird things that I discovered recently, and I'm happy that I discovered them recently and not long ago, is this weird thing called TikTok.
Yeah, where people sing and dance, right?
People sing and dance.
Isn't it something similar to that dub smash thing where people were?
Something similar.
How is it different? Because I can't gather the strength to even think about doing such stuff.
No. You've got an entire population of people from China, from India, who have just been handed over their first internet connections.
Right.
Okay. And it's not that they're not smart.
Hmm.
It's just that they don't know how to navigate.
Mm-hmm.
So they just do whatever somebody tells them.
Right.
Or we are having social media stars from TikTok and what's it called? Musical.ly or Musical.ly?
Musical.ly.
So people who cry passionately. There's an actual page called Boys Who Cry Passionately on Musical.ly. And if I show it to you, hopefully not.
No, it's okay. But can I Google it right now?
You can. It's on Facebook. Boys Who Cry Passionately on Musical.ly.
I won't go to Facebook. I'll just give it a short term. Boys Who Cry. There are videos of
boys crying
Musical.ly.
Yes.
Musical.ly.
And it is the weirdest thing. I mean, you're looking at, the twilight zone. What is happening to these people? Why are they doing it? They're pouring water over themselves.
Back off. Warrior affairs. Boys Who Cry Passionately. Bro, it's funny, but you know, I'm not laughing right now. I'm kind of disturbed. I don't want to see that.
Yeah, I hope. No, I'll show it. I'll show it once. Then probably you can decide if you want to.
No,
it's becoming
guilty.
It's becoming guilty.
You know what? I think I was in college, 6 or 8 years, or maybe zyada. So, under the garb of porn, lesbian porn, there was this video called Two Girls, One Cup. Everyone knows that. You see, you know what I'm talking about, right? So, I couldn't gather the strength. The second I saw the first, you know, the ad, yeah, the first glimpse, I was like, my friends were, you know, turning my neck. I was like, dekh saale. I was like, nahi ho payega, nahi ho payega. You know, it's not, you know, that bad. But,
no, but it is disturbing to watch that.
Exactly. I can't gather the strength to click it. I'm not going to see it. No,
yeah.
I understood. Men cry. I've cried.
No, it is not crying. It is showing you how violently I can cry. Okay. And this,
yeah,
they do funny additions, like, you know, just like we have a setup here. So I'll be looking into the camera. Some other random person will take, you know, his glass of water or a mug of water. And when he's crying, he'll pour it on his head to show his
other guy
covered in tears and he's completely devastated. I mean, you have to see it to understand the scale of what is happening. But this is where it has reached.
Okay.
This is where it has reached. So these clips, I don't think, are more than 15 seconds long.
Uh-huh.
Okay. And similar anywhere. Snaps are also, I think, destructible. I've not used Snapchat.
I used to.
I'm not, but I'm certainly not one of those people who went to delete or give one star rating to
imagine so, you know, I really watch his videos, Gary Vee, because he pumps you up, right?
Mm-hmm.
He tells you to work, man, work your ass off. That's what you need to do. Like, he's an angel, man. But the thing is that I also think that he has a power to make people do whatever he wants to right now because of his following. What if tomorrow Gary Vee tells you, are you crying on TikTok or are you crying on Musical.ly? You're not. What the fuck are you doing?
Yeah,
you need to cry. People are going to cry.
So,
sane people are going to cry, man.
Exactly. Hashtag challenges.
Hashtag challenges happen.
So, you know, I'd love to see the day hashtag read 2 books in a week.
Very subjective though.
Hashtag any 2 books in a
week.
It doesn't have to be a fiction book.
Mm.
It doesn't have to be a romance book. It doesn't
okay.
have to be a thriller. It doesn't
mm.
have to be anything. Just read a book.
Okay. And so you told me that people tell you that you are a writer and you haven't read Harry Potter.
Yeah.
Yeah. So something on those lines. So a confession, I don't read fiction. So that's why most of the books that you name, I know about them,
mm.
but I haven't read them. But that's my, you know, if I'm awake, you know, 24 hours, out of that, if I'm awake for, let's say, 18 hours, out of 18 hours, I think 90% of the time I'm reading. Something or the other.
Wow.
I'm always reading.
Okay.
I'm always reading. And it's not Instagram or something. I'm always reading something. But it's very, you know, hard for me to, you know, focus on a fiction story. The only time I did that was with Harry Potter. And I read that like a maniac. I read that. It was very simple. I didn't go Salman Rushdie on me, right? वो एक चीज अगर उसको भाई को बतानी होती है तो वो 4 पेज लेता है उसको बताने के लिए and then अच्छा ये बोलना था but you know his style I'm not a big fan of that guy but yeah so अलग अलग लोगों का अलग style I never you know I couldn't gather I bought books start किया maybe I'm fickle उस तरीके से but when I start reading something then I you know because I started with 100 Years of Solitude.
Okay.
People say that it's a great book. I started and finished it. Not a big fan. Though I like his writing style because wo ek page mein 50 years kaise cover kar leta hai, effortlessly. Really loved it. Loved it. But the story, I was like, yeah, especially when Salman Rushdie writes that best story I've ever, you know, read in 50 years or whatever.
Yeah.
I was like, not for me, maybe.
Okay.
So, not a big reader. Not a big fiction reader. But yeah, that's my thing. So people tell me that, why don't you read books? You're a writer. So I'm like, you know, when I grab a pen, one's going to tell me that, okay, you can't write.
And sometimes it does influence the way you write, right?
Yeah.
So when I was writing
mm.
14,000 and above
right.
for the first time and, you know, all of that.
Mm.
So I thought, you know, why don't I take a page out of somebody else's book and try to emulate, you know, what? Because it's been massively successful and all that.
Right.
And when I finished writing, this happens a lot with me. I write 5-10 pages,
mm.
I decide it's not good enough and I delete it.
Right.
Okay. It happens a lot with me.
Uh-huh.
So maybe 200 odd pages
I'll tell you another thing.
Yeah, maybe 200 odd pages I've written for my book. I probably must have written somewhere in the ballpark of 900, 1000.
Okay.
And then deleted all of that. Arrived at that. Because I understood that by reading fiction, it's sort of affecting my ability
to...
It
does.
Write.
Mm.
So, I don't completely stop reading fiction. But my list of books which I read are definitely more non-fiction than they are fiction.
Yeah. So, there was this guest over here. She was a stylist. She's a stylist. She said something that I really relate to it. And Amrita.
Hmm.
Amrita Saluja, right? So
yeah, the last episode.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Not last, but...
Yeah, one of them.
So the thing is ki usne bataya ki you need to learn, you need to see other people's work.
Mm.
But if you read it, if you watch it and you immediately start working on your project, that might, be
that
counterproductive. Or you will be a phony, you will be in a way plagiarizing, in a way. You absorb it, you rest, and then you take your time, you build your own. That's how art is done. That's what I think. I mean, yeah, you take it. And when you said that delete it, you won't believe what happened to me in Delhi. Delhi didn't suit me at all. So I was in Delhi working. So I, after that, when I wrote Beyond Three Words, after that, I wanted to write the second book because I'm a writer, right? I wanted to write the second. I was like, yeah, let's just, go full throttle, write another book. So I was telling myself that, okay, I'm going to write another book. Beyond Three Words happened. It happened. It was happening. I wasn't like, okay, today I'm going to write this. This thing, you said that you deleted a few pages. I wrote a whole fucking book and I was creating a series because of so many things, online shows and all. I was like, I created worlds, imaginary, whatever, maps and all. The way things were happening, I was like, I can do this. I can do this. I have created characters. Bro, I finished 50 to 60,000 words. That was first.
That's an entire book.
Exactly.
That's an entire book.
First of the series.
Mm.
Bro, there, a day came, select all, delete. Never look back. When I told
I
a few
know.
People...
You're really brave.
Exactly. People were like, you fucking idiot. I was like, listen, do you see any
regret?
Exactly. I'm like, I'm really happy. Wo bojh tha, wo burden tha mere upar. I was like, mujhe likhna hai, mujhe bahar aana hai. Mujhe de deta, mujhe de deta. I'm like, listen. But yeah, you understand. So I think if you're not feeling it, right? If you're not feeling it, don't push yourself. Don't push yourself.
I don't
it
like
will take
people
time.
Who... I mean, if it's a strategy which works for them, completely fine with that. But, we talked about something sometime back, like people who write with the end goal of getting a Netflix show or end goal of a movie. That, I think, is disturbing. I mean, they have the talent to do that.
Yeah.
They have the talent to do that. But I don't think I could do something like that. Write something in the hopes and expectations that it will become a movie.
Yeah.
Or I know one writer, which I will not name. He writes he writes specifically that, I met this guy some time back. He writes, he's not published anything, by the way.
Okay.
Kyunki abhi tak wo wahi mode mein hai ki main aisa likhunga ki wo movie aasani se ban sake.
Movie aasani se ban
sake. Ya wo show aasani se ban sake.
What shit,
man. Yeah. He does that. So, one of the first things he told me is that, Vikram, in your books, there's not a lot of sex.
वो बिकता है, grabs attention, ऐसा वो
नहीं
आएगा।
हाँ हाँ, like
yeah,
there's not a lot of sex.
हाँ,
I said it's a little difficult to imagine sex when somebody is running behind you with AK-47. That doesn't happen.
That'll be a hell of a sex, man.
Yeah, I mean with the AK-47 or without it. But that was where he went with it.
Yeah.
Because there is no reason for sex in my story.
If there isn't, there isn't.
There isn't. There's a little romance, and one of the reasons which drives the plot forward is the romance part.
Right.
But apart from it's a very sort of, I wouldn't go to the extent of saying platonic because the reasons are not platonic.
Okay.
But
yeah, AK-47 and all. Yeah.
No.
It doesn't sound platonic.
Yeah. Nobody would choose to face an AK-47 because of somebody they love.
Yeah.
Okay. So, did I say that wrong? Nobody would choose, to be in front of an AK-47 if they didn't have the motivation of saving somebody they loved.
Okay. Yeah, that makes much more sense.
Yeah. Okay. So,
early was a bit dark. I liked the previous one though. That's just me.
That's just me. No, I like that stuff. So, that was the point. There wasn't a lot of there wasn't anything rather. I mean, on the romance, few of the girls who read the book, which romance in here. And I said, you know, a lot of the girls who have read the book said that I appreciated there is not a lot of romance. There's stuff for the girl to do.
Yeah.
Okay, she's not a trope and she's not some kind of, you know, damsel in distress that we're saving throughout the plot of the book. So, I wrote that and this guy came up and said, you know, isme ye nahi hai, usme wo nahi hai, you should add this, you should, you know, sprinkle a little controversy here so that, you know, papers will pick your name up and, you know, publications will do this and do that. In hindsight, I said, kyun nahi gaya yaar, book successful hoti thi meri. Okay, but then...
I'm sure you're happy that you didn't do that.
I'm very happy I didn't
do
that. The book, I would not say is a grand success. It is a success in a way that I've joined a very select club of people who have ever put pen to paper and got it in front of you.
Okay.
Okay. So, out of 7 billion people in the world, how many of them are writers? So, I'm happy being part of that small group of people who...
The community. Yeah,
the community. I'm happy being part of
it. I like when storytelling is pure.
Exactly.
It's pure. I love it. It's just, it's hard to explain, you know, the way I feel, the way you feel about it. But the second it gets all fake and all, you can easily tell.
I've
met writers. For them, it's just marketing. It's just that's all they do. They write with the marketing thing in their heads.
Yeah. And marketing is one of those things which sort of hit me like a brick. Why should I have to go up in front of thousands of people and constantly tell them, buy this book, isme ye hai, isme wo hai. So I always thought that, you know, why should I market? But it serves its purpose, doesn't it? Marketing is important because otherwise how will people know that you've written?
Yeah.
Okay. And as I said, in this goldfish memory generation, people can't remember you for more than 5 seconds.
Yeah.
So this constant hammering of, you know, this is Vikram, this is Abhimanyu, this is Vikram, this is Abhimanyu, this is Vikram, this is Abhimanyu. Fine, show me his work.
Yeah. Oh, you're saying that works?
That works.
Okay. Okay. I thought you were going to say that it pisses people off. But no.
It pisses people off if done improperly. That's the secret to marketing.
Right.
And it's a formula that I haven't figured out.
Right.
But I know this is how it happens. So it's like a quantum computer.
So
it gives you the result, but it doesn't show you how you get
how it's done. So, so there was this book event, right? I went there and I met this author. Apparently, he was one of the top 50 or 100 best-selling Indian authors. I wasn't that impressed with that guy and the way he was marketing his book during the event. Like, if you already are 100 ke andar andar, maybe that's his way. It works for him. I just, you know, observed that guy. People are coming. Those who didn't show, he already came with a, you know, like he had already promoted his work, which was smart, right? You know, people come and they know that, okay, there's this author. Who's gonna... I did that, but his scale was, you know.
Much higher.
Yeah, exactly. Because he had seen all that. It was new to me. But when the readers came and when they did not show interest, which is all right. Everyone is not. Yeah, people are just going to pass. Sometimes I was midway telling people about it. They say, yeah. And they left. I was like, shit. Like, you bitch. But you can't say anything. You learn. And I love that. You know, it's very interesting. That kind of hustle, I really loved it. The same event that we did there.
I'm
really surprised that we didn't exchange books over there. Maybe you and I had that thing going that, okay, I'm selling books. I don't know. Sometimes, you know, that thing.
This is how it worked out. So, being from, as I said, you know, I had a sales background.
Yeah.
Okay. So I had said ki yaar main 15 book leke aaya hu. Bech ke jaunga.
Mera bhi same tha. I remember I sold out like I had 12 or 13 and I was bookless after some. So yeah, but coming back to that guy was called, all those people who were, you know, leaving the whole thing. That author was calling people back. That Wapis ho. Inko free de do meri book. Inko free. And I saw that look on the girl's face that I don't want your book. I don't want your book. And then she could, maybe she was shy or whatever. She just took and got a picture, clicked and all. So sometimes marketing goes really bizarre.
Yeah, it goes bizarre to the point where maybe you and I will make that face. But certainly not to that guy. Because
he was like, he was
into
certainly it.
Certainly not to that guy.
So business minded, and which you have to be.
You have to be at some point.
Didn't like the approach. All I'm saying is didn't like the approach.
So the same day that, you know, I bought those books. Okay. So the reason why I was so hesitant to give it to anybody for free was because all the books I had bought myself.
Mm.
Because the kind of deal that I have with my publisher is that I don't get any books upfront.
Okay.
So anybody can go.
Yeah, neither do I.
Yeah.
Neither do I. Same.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So anybody who can go to Amazon, they can purchase the link.
Yeah.
They can purchase the book through the link. Or I can get the books and then sort of sell
them. Same.
It.
Same, yeah.
And that's what happened. They said, I've got 15 books.
Mm.
So I've invested so much.
Mm.
And more are going to be invested. So I have to give away a lot of this stuff.
Yeah.
And this involves a lot of giveaways.
Yeah.
Okay, a lot of giveaways.
Mm.
And at that point, because I had Beyond Earth already going in, my campaigns were
You need to manage it.
Yeah, you just couldn't manage at that point. And you said, how many are you going to give away?
Right.
How many? And again, trends do affect the way, you know, your books come out.
Yeah.
So for example, last year also, there was still this trend of Indian mythology going on.
Yeah.
There still is. Rather.
Yeah, I have forgotten the name. This heavy guy, man. Kya naam hai uska? He was
there. Yeah. The one with Tika.
No, I don't know about the Tika, but he's like big, huge guy. He writes...
you're talking about Devdutt Patnaik.
Patnaik writes about Indian mythology.
Yeah.
No. This guy writes fiction. But it's very, you know, it has that mythological and fantasy combined together. Very famous guy.
I'm not sure if you're talking about Amish.
No, not the Naga
series. Because Amish started this whole...
He came up with the Shiva trilogy, right?
Yeah, he blew it out of the park.
Whatever. He was the main guy during our event. Do you remember?
Not sure.
The guest of honor, the guy who was, you know, people were in lines to see that guy. Dark guy.
I think
you're
talking about Devdutt Patnaik.
No, I'm sure it's not Devdutt Patnaik because Devdutt Patnaik writes about Gita, Mahabharata. His book has got something. Whatever, just fuck it. So, yeah, I understand what you're saying.
Huh.
So, at that time, people were reading a lot about mythology.
Mythology.
Yeah.
So, if people are reading a lot about Indian mythology,
hmm.
So, of course, you'll have, you know, people who will instantly latch on so that they can get some sort of eyeballs on their work because some people are looking at that.
Hmm.
So, when Amish came out with his book, it was instantly an explosion for the other authors.
Because no one had tapped into that.
No one had. And to his credit, Amish, a lot of people have, you know, criticized his storytelling and, you know, the way his books are written and everything of that sort. But I don't think that really is an issue because this was a story that everybody already knew.
Hmm.
Okay.
It's the way he put it front of
you. Yeah. So India already has a huge connection to gods.
Right.
Any religion to be, any religion for that matter.
Yeah.
And to see Shiva transform from a godlike stature coming down to a nomad in Tibet.
Yeah.
And from there his story starts. That was something people really lapped it up.
Yeah.
Said, wow, this is something which is amazing.
Right.
And after, I think, if I remember correctly, he ended his trilogy with saying something to the tone of the next I'm going to tackle is Mahabharata. Okay. But that didn't happen. He came up with
Sita.
He came up with the Ram trilogy
next.
So even the Ram trilogy, he thought, you know, let me present it in a different angle.
Yeah.
So first book was Ram.
Right.
Second book was Sita.
Yeah. I still remember the cover of Sita. Sita is going all, you know.
Yeah, she's going ham on somebody.
Yeah.
And the third book is about Ravan.
Huh.
Okay. So Ravan...
Has he come out with Ravan yet?
No. He's going to launch it.
Hmm.
But it was amazing the way he connected with all these people.
Right.
Now, what happens during this time, especially if you're an author,
if
something is blowing up, then your book about something which is not what is blowing up does not get noticed.
Hmm. Especially if you're new in the game.
Especially if you're new. Because if you're new, nobody wants to invest.
Mm.
Okay. And now publication houses do tell you that, you know, we are not going to return your manuscripts.
Mm.
So anybody who's an author which is watching or anybody who's planning to watch, who's planning to write and watching this right now, publishing houses are the places where dreams go to die.
Yeah.
Okay, they're the places where you...
Lodi mein use karte honge jalane ke liye.
Haan, wahi karte honge. Because... And I have to appreciate their viewpoint also. They get thousands of these submissions.
Yeah, but I also feel, this is like my, you know, the conspiracy theory part talking, because I also think that they choose, they're selective, and there are certain people who want such stories out and they don't want such stories out. Some of them.
Could be.
I think so. And that's how the agents work as well. the literary agents.
I've never been in touch with one, by the way.
I have. I can't say that about her because I want my work to get published. Plus,
right.
she's pretty cool
hmm.
with her work. Let's hope how. But whatever, it's a dirty game at the end of the day, like any other thing. Like people want to get noticed and dreams get killed.
Yeah, as I said, they're the places where dreams go to die. So you send up all these, a lot of. I mean, if you want to become a writer, you have to deal with rejection a lot.
Yeah, that's like
part a of lot.
Yeah,
I mean,
you have to love it. You have to love the rejection.
Yeah, I'm not sure. I mean, that's bordering on sadomasochism.
I don't think sado, but masochistic. Yeah, a bit. Yeah.
No, because the reason it didn't affect me.
Hmm.
I mean, being rejected did not affect me at all.
Yeah.
Okay. The reason is I was being rejected all my life for everything.
Huh.
Okay. And, you know, this is what I've got. लाइफ में मेरे हेटर्स बहुत कम है बट देर आर जस्ट अ लॉट ऑफ पीपल हु जस्ट डोंट गिव अ डैम ओके सो आई एम वेरी फॉर्चुनेट टू बी इन दैट पोजीशन I'd rather have 1,000 people not give a damn than one person shouting up and down and said, I hate you, I hate your work, this, that, this troll people and whatnot.
Yeah.
So, sometime back on YouTube, when I started YouTube, so this is one guy, okay, jo sare videos dekhega, sare post padhega.
But,
he'll always comment something nasty.
Haan.
Okay. And then I figured out that, you know,
he's a fan in denial, it's that simple.
Yeah,
he's
because he's giving you so much time of
exactly,
the day. He's thinking
exactly.
of ways to
he
come.
Loves it.
He loves it. Okay. So, this guy, whatever his name was, because his name was also obscure.
Yeah.
So, he used to come up with, you know, these savage statements and, you know, these slam dunks and everything.
Uh-huh.
And after a while, you just start realizing that, ye kya farak padega ye mujhse? Kuch bhi bole, ye kya farak padta?
Exactly.
And That's how you start dealing with rejection in the first place. So if you're a writer, start dealing with rejection, number one. Number one rejection is the publishing house is not going to accept.
Yeah.
Number two rejection is when you publish your book, your editors are going to come up and say, you know, all this is not
going
to
happen.
Okay?
Yeah.
So I think there's a phrase in writing which they call kill your babies or something.
Okay.
Something of that sort. which means essentially because the book is your baby.
Yeah.
Okay. And somebody is saying that, you know, iska haath kaat do, iska pair kaat do. And it is in your head not acceptable.
Yeah.
In your head you say, no, this makes perfect sense. This is what this character is supposed to do.
Mm.
This guy is going to say, no, it doesn't.
Mm.
It's not going to fly. Please take it out. Okay. So a lot of authors have this back and forth with their editors.
Mm.
And having a good editor is supremely important.
Mm.
Supremely important.
Yep.
I realized it the hard way.
Yeah, so did I.
Realizing the very hard way.
Yeah.
So that's going to be a second rejection.
Yeah.
The third rejection is going to be when you are beyond these first two stages.
Hmm.
You know, you've got your book past the publisher.
Yeah, it's out there.
You've got
it's
your book
there.
Past your editor.
Yeah.
Now you feel that you've been handed the keys of heaven and the gates of Saint Peter are going to open and you're going to enter into this, you know, loud crowd, you know, shouting your name, ready to give you a ride of the wave.
Hmm.
No.
Yeah, never happens.
No.
It's,
no,
it's, all in, it's all in your head.
It's all in your head.
Yeah.
So people are just going to, you know, look at your book. Somebody's going to roll their eyes. Somebody's going to. One very, I don't know if there's one comment I remember from the literature fest last year. So he said, you know, what is this book about? You know, this is about love and relationships and. They've been caught in a, you know, sort of a crossfire between national security and everything.
Right.
He said, is this book really promoting war? I said, no, it's not promoting war.
And shut the fuck up.
This is what happened. Is it glorifying the army? No. I'm sorry, but I really have to protest. Okay. Bye. And that's how I dealt with it. Okay, but somebody else, I think somebody was watching me right next to me.
Oh, was he or she young? Like,
no, yeah, mid-20s, early 30s maybe.
Okay.
Yeah, but she just went out there. So, a lot of people will come up to you, will say that, you know, your work is crap or your writing style is not good or X, Y, and Z, whatever reasons that they may have. But ultimately, you have to deal with that rejection also.
Yeah.
Okay. And then, just suppose that you've cracked the publisher, you've cracked the editor, you've cracked the audience. Now comes the pressure of building a better book.
Yeah. Because you have to, you can't.
You have,
do,
to.
You have to.
Because your audience is now expecting something, Abhimanyu ne ye likha, wo ye likhega, which will be even more super duper awesome than the last one. And they just pile their expectations. A lot of famous authors have actually said this, that, you know, I've never felt so stressed. I thought I was stressed in my first book. I've never felt so stressed when I'm writing my second book.
Yeah.
Because the way the audience wants stuff from me, it just blows my mind. Some writers go into depression. Okay, because they feel that it's not good enough. Even J.K. Rowling spoke about it. Like when Harry Potter came out, and I mean, what an inspiring story of J.K. Rowling. I mean, it is, not read the books, but I know her story and everything.
12 rejections.
That's a long time. Almost living out of, as I think in her own words, she says, as poor as it is possible to be in England without being homeless. Okay, so that is where she was.
Yeah.
And writing Harry Potter, this thing apparently blowing up.
Right.
And when she was writing the second one, she said, I'm not sure what to do now.
Mm.
Because all these people...
You mean the second in the series?
In the series.
Okay.
She said, I don't know what to do now. Because all these people have read Harry Potter and they love Harry and they love Ron and all these characters. And they would just massacre me if any one of those characters, you know, takes a path which my... reader does not want it to be taken.
Okay, have you heard of the new rumor? It's just a rumor, it's floating right now. Dumbledore, I heard it somewhere, I think in a podcast. Dumbledore and Grindelwald, Grindelwald, they had gay relationship, like they were banging constantly.
No, she already accepted that Dumbledore was gay.
And Grindelwald, like these two are the ones.
That
have you seen Fantastic Beasts series?
Not yet.
No?
Not yet.
So yeah, John Depp plays Vo. So yeah, that's the thing. I mean, I was just laughing over it because you just mentioned it. So yeah, so people don't want...
So some people do that. Some people get massively pressured.
Yeah.
It's like, okay, what am I going to do? What if this character happens? The other side of the spectrum is some guy like G.R.R. Martin. Who doesn't give a fuck.
Bro, you just hit the spot right now. Because I want... So, best show ever. For me.
Yep, best show ever.
Best show ever. No.
Breaking Bad and then this.
Okay, so for you it's second.
For me it's second.
Okay, for me it's like... I can't... It's just... it's insane. So, since the final season is coming out, let's just do a thing right now. I'll share my prediction and I want you to share your prediction. And we'll just put it out. Let's see what people have to say about it. So, I think... if I try to enter the writer's mind, he would try to, restore the balance by getting Baratheon back to Iron Throne. That will be Gendry, because he was missing, right?
He's been missing so long.
Yeah, and he just showed in the trailer, right? He just showed up.
Yeah,
he was there. So if he has to do that, that's what I think the writer will do. But what I want a fucking Lannister to sit on the throne. I want it. That's me. And that's what I'm saying and banking on, that a Lannister at the end will sit on the throne. It can be Jaime. It won't be Tyrion. What's his name?
Tyrion.
It won't be Tyrion. But so just think about it. Like if, the dragon, mother of dragons, she sits on the throne, it'll be like, that's what everyone wants, because she's the...
He said himself that the ending is going to be bittersweet.
Bittersweet, right?
Yeah. He's been very specific about that. That the ending will be bittersweet. Now, every single...
Just saying, if Daenerys Targaryen, right, if she becomes the queen, she sits on the throne, it'll just leave people in that, that's what we really wanted, victory, sach ki jeet hui, vagaira, vagaira. I don't think Martin thinks like that. He fucks people up, right?
Martin, that's why I said he's on the complete opposite end of the spectrum.
Yeah.
He doesn't give a shit.
Yeah.
I mean...
So what's your thing? What do you think is going to happen?
Number one, predictions, I've stopped doing
it. I just want you to do it one. It's okay. You're wrong, right?
If I have to say, I think more or less Tyrion will end up on top.
Quite possibly.
More or less. Because Okay, everything, I just want to talk about this, which is so funny. A lot of people don't realize it, that Jon Snow, for all his graciousness, for all his honesty, for all his, you know, goody-two-shoes behavior, he's actually a trope here. Okay, and I'll explain myself.
The writer is using him very appropriately just to distract.
Just to distract, and he's putting all the expectations on somebody's head and then turning them over. For example, remember a time when John took somebody out by himself?
By himself, you mean that not even with the help of Valyrian steel? Like, for example,
every time, let's say he's battling the wildlings.
Okay.
Okay, so somebody from Castle Pack is tracking him down. Once he gets to the wildlings, and once he gains their respect and everything, so then again he's backed up by somebody.
Right.
Okay. And then he's constantly being saved.
Yeah.
Number one, once he, tries to go head to head with, what's his name?
The one who tortured the war.
Yeah.
Even he received.
I keep forgetting. Roose Bolton.
Okay.
Bolton, not Roose Bolton.
Yeah.
Ramsay Bolton.
Ramsay.
Yeah. Which, by the way, is my favorite villainous character ever. This guy is superb.
He caught you the moment he fiend that he's going to help guy.
Greyjoy.
He's going to help and then he turns up.
Oh man, I mean, that was severe.
Yeah.
So, even during that time, even because of his, you know, great noble posture and everything, but he still requires saving.
Right.
At that time, Sansa saves him because, you know, she comes with the Knights of the Way. Spoiler alert, please don't skip ahead. I'll probably put an annotation that if you don't...
Now, if anyone who hasn't seen Game of Thrones abhi tak ke season, ab kuch nahi spoiler.
Again, when he is getting that specimen of the undead back
to...
Again, he has to be saved by Daenerys.
Yeah.
Okay.
So where are you getting at?
Like, I'm saying that Jon, for all of his, honest to God behavior...
Mm.
Isn't really perfectly suited. He's shown to be a king because he has all the qualities of a king.
Mm.
But he rarely gets the job done himself.
Mm.
He always has to rely on somebody else to do it.
Exactly.
In a way, that is fine because ultimately no kingdom can run alone. You always have to rely on different people to do that. Daenerys, again, as you said, if she sits on the throne just like that,
it'll be very
anticlimactic.
Exactly.
It'll be very anticlimactic.
It won't be anticlimactic, but it will be anticlimactic because, you know...
Let's just be sure. Either Jon is going to die
yeah.
or Daenerys is going to die or both of them are going to die.
Yeah.
I think so somebody from these two are going to die.
Yeah.
I don't think...
Because she has to unite with Khal Drogo, right? She's going to die.
Maybe. And, there's just one person that I think is safe.
Okay.
That's Tyrion.
Yeah.
Because if Ghar Martin, as we call Ghar Martin kills Tyrion, people are going to come to his house with pitchforks.
I think he thinks, a writer always puts his brain, he always puts himself in the book.
Yeah.
I think he has put himself in Tyrion Lannister.
Maybe.
Martin.
Maybe.
So it's quite possible he might become the king, you know.
Maybe. But that's the only prediction that's the only prediction I'll make. And I'll prove it to you because in my phone, there's actually a group. I'll show you the group itself.
It's a GOT group?
Yes.
Oh,
no, I mean, we talk about a lot of different groups. Usually it's called intellectual Bakchodi, but only for this it's called GOD Bakchodi.
Right.
Okay, so that is all that we do on that group. As the Game of Thrones approaches, the whole group changes. I mean, the entire personality of the group changes. So, yeah, we are into Game of Thrones. We don't know what we're going to do after Game of Thrones ends. What are we going to talk
about? Exactly. Anyway, bro, Beyond Earth, let's just talk about it.
Beyond Earth.
Yeah, your project. Stargazing, space. Another thing. So, you know, when I think about space, right? When I think about space, I just go numb. Numb in a way that, what the fuck are we doing? Like, you know, when you look up, I think it happens to everyone. Like, I get this feeling that you are fucking nothing. What are you running for? Kya kar rahe ho? Jab dekho aap, aapko pata chalta hai that it's just a planet. It's just, you know, a particle of sand in this whole beach, right? And you are nothing. You're nothing. So, we shouldn't stress so much. It's, for me, space is, you know, it always leads to introspection. And this is my conclusion that you can do just upar dekh. Kya kya ho raha hai dekh. Just imagine and just calm the fuck down.
My earliest memory that I can recall is of the stars.
Right.
Earliest memory that I can recall, which I can place into context.
Okay. Yeah, when you know that, okay, this was your first memory.
That is of the stars. From a very young age, I was always interested. I was, even, when people say, define your purpose or this thing. So I always tell them, or at least I tell myself, that my purpose is to become a vacuum cleaner for knowledge.
Oh.
Okay. That is my sole function.
Right.
Okay. Sometimes people, I have this reputation of being Garib Aadmi Ka Google. Amongst my friends, at least. So, they said, yeah, they call me Virulkar mostly. They don't talk to me by Vikram. So, are Virulkar, ye kya hai, wo kya hai? So, sometimes they'll be surprised. I'll just give them random information on anything. Okay. So, that is my purpose in life.
Yeah.
It's to be an acquirer of knowledge and a storer of knowledge.
I have a friend like, Virulkar. His name is Gurpal Singh. Shout out to Gurpal Singh.
Hey, Gurpal. So, that's what my function is.
Yeah.
I store knowledge, I acquire knowledge, I acquire more knowledge, I store more knowledge, I acquire more knowledge, I store more knowledge.
Right.
That is my function. There are very few things that I find dull and mundane.
Hmm.
Okay. Astronomy is one of those things which caught on and gripped me like nothing else.
Mm.
This whole idea of, looking up at the stars, there's this whole new different place out there that nobody knows about, nobody talks about, nobody. And I find it a little frustrating that we are not talking about those things.
Mm.
Okay. There's this great quote by Calvin and Hobbes. If people sat out and looked at the stars every night, we would start doing things a little more differently.
Mm.
I'm not saying it perfectly right, but that is
I get the idea.
In the context. So when you look at, first time when I looked through a telescope and I looked at the moon, and I just gasped and said, wow, what beauty, what, this is indescribable, I cannot put it into words.
Hmm.
And through my exploration of astronomy came my exploration of other subjects.
Right.
Like people got really excited for, let's say a rover is going to Mars.
Hmm.
But you just don't need astronomy for that. You also need to understand engineering. You also need to understand rocket science. You also need to understand software. You also
physics
need to understand rocketry. You need to understand a lot of these things.
Mm.
Okay. And that's how my appreciation for the sciences sort of started growing.
Mm.
And if not astronomy, I would definitely have been doing something in biology.
Okay.
Yeah. Because that is also something that fascinates me to know.
Mm.
So, I was there's a little bit of an odd story to how Beyond Earth got started. So I gave my 12th, and throughout my life I was an average student, somebody who had to be sort of whipped in order to work, because I could never understand why people are just asking me to gobble information and regurgitate it back in the same way. It just didn't work for me. And something really odd happened in my 12th, that is, I failed my 12th.
Okay. Oh, okay. Perfect. Okay. Respectful. Yeah.
And I did it in spectacular fashion. Yeah. In the sense.
How good were you in chemistry?
I was okay.
You were okay.
I hated organics.
So it was CBSE board when I was in 12th, right? And the passing marks in Seri were 23. I got 24. I passed by one mark because I was at Rang De Basanti ka premiere. Usse pehle thi. Bilkul usse do din pehle mere board ke exam. So yeah, science student but sucked at it.
No, this is how it happened. All my subjects, average marks.
Right.
And what I plan to do is, once mera 12th ho jayega, then I'll enroll for BSc.
But 12th hua nahi.
12th hua nahi. Kyunki yaar, the reason I say spectacular fashion is because all my subjects, I got okay marks.
Hmm.
And in maths, I got 1 and 2.
How do you do that?
I could not. I came out sort of numb because I'd never failed before.
How do you get 1 in maths? You can get 0. How did you get 1?
1 or 2, and it was like that. 2 and 4. I still have the mark sheet somewhere which I tried to look at. So I came out, I told my mom. And they were doing this thing. They were looking online against your sort of, what do you call, your hall ticket number?
Yeah, hall ticket number.
So, my name just wasn't showing up and it was freaking my mom out. And my dad was saying, chill out, it will come in some time. Maybe the servers are over there or whatever. So, me and one of my friends, Ashay, both were sitting and, they were handing out the college leaving certificate or the passing certificate and the result sheet.
Mm.
And when my name got called up, the PO who was there said,
You need to translate that.
So, you don't need to give it to him.
Okay.
ओके सो आई सेड क्यों ना नहीं आप पास नहीं हुए ना सो एंड दैट टाइम आई फेल्ट लाइक समबडी हिट मी ओवर द हेड विद अ क्लब आई लुक्ड एट माय फ्रेंड एंड ही सेड नहीं ठीक है हो जाएगा फिर उसका भी ना वो भी फेल हो गया हम दोनों एक दूसरे को देख के हंस रहे इन दैट शॉक मोमेंट बट आई केम डाउन एंड आई टोल्ड यू नो माय मॉम एंड डैड नहीं ये फेल हो गया सर पता ना शुक्र एक तो I really, really respect my parents because...
Not going hard on you with that?
No, they didn't go. They didn't go. They said, it's fine. We'll figure out. We'll
and
figure
you out. Know, what do I think? At that time, parents don't... They do you think they weren't angry? They, I'm sure they wanted to whack
they,
you.
They were angry. My mom started crying.
But she must be crying because she was holding her anger down. She wanted to bash you. But the thing is, parents at that time think that this kid might do something weird. They are under that pressure, you know. Ye fail ho gaya hai. We don't want him to do anything stupid because kids do.
I know.
They commit suicide. It's sad. It's sad. Mm. But that's what parents think at that time. And I think any wise mother and father. Please.
But so I failed. They came out. They said, and they also thought, like, ऐसा तो नहीं हो सकता कि मतलब बाकी सब subject में तू अच्छे से निकल गया, पर इसमें इतना बुरा मार नहीं खा सकता. Okay. And I sort of. After, you know, a week or two, I started really questioning myself and I thought, kya ho gaya? Should I do it? Should I not do it? That was the point where my entire faith in the academic system went for a toss.
Okay.
And I went to Nerul and all these places and they said, you know, ki dekho abhi jitna bhi ho gaya hai, tumhara paper rechecking bhi checking ka, toh, whatever it is. But it won't help you right now. So what you need to do is you need to prepare for your September exams.
Right.
And clear it and back. And I'm telling you, I didn't even bother studying. Okay? Because I thought, what's the use? September, I went for the exam. And this is me not studying at all. And I wrote almost like 37, 38 marks ka. And I ended up with 35 marks and I passed.
Same happened to me, okay. Nuts. Yeah.
And, you know, it sort of reinforced that belief that you know, these people are just looking for a mold. That's
yeah,
it.
Yeah,
that,
a template. Yeah,
that,
yeah.
It's just a template. Mm. That's all that they want. They don't want anything else.
They are suffering with their own whatever. They just want to put ticks over ticks, a ticks, template. Ticks. Yeah.
Not even those ticks. Yeah. Like, there is a block. If you don't, it's a square block in a round peg. That was my situation. So I came out. And I started working.
Yeah.
So I was 18 and I used to get this 20, 30 rupees.
Just to cut you off in the middle. You won't believe, because you said that they only look for a template.
Yeah.
So when I was in law school, right? So in comparative law, the subject, right? So there's this small, you know, so since it was like early semester, so they don't go hardcore law on you initially. So they do end up, you know, introducing little anecdotes and all. So they were talking about Cinderella story, like how was that, you know, comparative law, how is it, how law is like, blah, 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 whatever. Bro, you have no idea what... I had the balls to write shit in my paper. I did that. I wrote words like spanking and all. And I told my friends, listen, they don't check. I'm telling you, they don't check. They just, you know, I wrote shit on my exam and I passed that exam. That was a proof that, you know, what...
What was that movie, Shah Rukh Khan ka?
I don't remember.
Palat, palat wala.
Dilwale.
So you have actual photographs of people writing Dilwale Dulhania story ka in the papers.
Right.
Okay, and then pass it.
Yeah.
So fortunately, Max Mio can't do that.
Yeah.
But once that happened, you know, I came out with a feeling that, you know, it's not going to work out. Me and academics don't gel.
Yeah.
And I started working instantly. And I used to get 20, 30 rupees ka pocket money.
Yeah.
And I started working in a call center. Theek hai? And my first salary was 14,000. So I went pagal.
Yeah.
For an 18-year-old, that is how it went. You know, get me my new phone, get me my new shoes, get me my new jacket.
Right.
You know, so I was becoming like, what's her name? Whatever. So, I don't want to mention it.
Yeah.
So that's how it happened. And then I started college again, first year of BSc. And I started, maths, physics, and chemistry. These are three subjects I'm going to take. And I just couldn't reconcile the fact that they are not looking for any inspired thought. They're not looking for my view on the subject simply because my view isn't important.
Right.
And in retrospect, a student's view isn't important.
Isn't important, yeah.
Okay, but I couldn't, it was that rebellious phase of mine. You know, listen to what I have to say. So I would do weird things in maths just to tick people off. So sometimes they gave a sum for Venn diagrams. So I would just to get the answer, I would say this can be done with differential equations. Here
okay.
you go. And I used to get a nice undown.
Right.
But they said, but no, like I can do this. This is the way it can be done. I'm saving you 10 steps here.
Yeah.
Okay. So no, I'm not interested.
Mm.
Okay. And later on, I did that. Was not successful. I understood the subject, but nobody was willing to understand what I have to write. These are the points. To be very brief, we don't have the time to check all of you guys' papers.
Yeah.
Hum log point dekhte hain, point dekhe, marks dekhe, khatam karte hain. We don't want to listen to your takes, or we don't want to understand what you have to write. So that was sort of my breakup with academia. Okay, ki ab ho gaya, ab mujhe nahi karna. By that time, I was, this is another 2-3 years later on. So I was working for JP Morgan Chase.
Right.
Okay. And it was getting to me. Ki matlab, main udhar, I said to myself that I'm not going to conform to that expectation of society, that padhai karo, padhai ke baad degree karo, degree ke baad job karo, job ke baad shaadi karo, shaadi ke baad bachche karo, bachcho ka padhai karo, bachche ki shaadi karo, aur uske baad mar jao. Okay, I knew that I was not going to conform to that. So why am I conforming to this office space? There is something that I love, the stars. That is something that I've always loved. People don't know about it. And there does not exist a service in the market that can do this. I mean, there were already great groups doing stuff back there. They're in Mumbai at least. So there was Nehru Planetarium, of course. Always done a stellar job.
Yeah.
Marathi Vidyan Parishad, which was there, used to take people out for stargazing. Again, a great job. I said, let me reverse the chain. Or let me reverse the tables. In order for people to do stargazing, the biggest thing which was stopping them was traveling.
Yeah.
Especially in the night time.
Mm.
So I came up with the idea, you don't come anywhere, I'll come to you.
Right.
And suddenly, I mean not suddenly, it was a very rough, soul-breaking period later, but people started turning up. They said, you know, we want this.
Yeah.
So I went from lugging, and there was a time when after I left JP, I had no sense. I was just this excited 20, 21, 22 year old. I said, you know, I'm just going to start it. I'm just going to wing it. Okay. No savings, no nothing. Main nikal chuka. Beyond earth karega, beyond earth karega, beyond earth karega. And in the next 6 months, I ended up penniless. Okay. Things went to such a bad point that even though my mom, dad still, and that is why I love them so much, they did not stop supporting me.
Yeah.
They always kept, nahi, tu kar. Teko jo karna tu kar. And you know, when I listen to my friends and their parents and the way they sort of force their kids, it just doesn't connect with me because my mom and dad has never done that to me.
Yeah.
Okay. And it came to one point where I remember one day very particularly, after doing the session, I was so tired and I did not have money enough to take a rickshaw to my house.
Okay.
And I walked, I think, for around the better part of 8 kilometers with all my gear, with my telescope, with my tripod, with everything. And that point it dawned on me ki nahi kuch karna padega. Okay. So I started reaching out to more people. I started, I found two great partners. I found one partner is Let's Camp Out.
Yeah.
The other partner is Mumbai Travelers. And I've been working with them for, I think, the better part of five years now. And it's just been exploding since then.
Right.
We've taken so many people out and shown them a world that they have never even thought of.
That's what I really want you to, you know, talk about. Like, be very, because I find it really amazing and fascinating, I want you to tell people what exactly Beyond Earth
does. Okay, so for example, for a session.
Yeah.
So usually when people call me up,
right,
they say, you know, Vikram, we want to do something like this. So if they're not tired for time and not tired for traveling,
right,
so I will usually suggest come to one of my outdoor sessions.
Right.
So what we do is we will take you out to an environment which is mostly pristine, but try to keep the exposure to nature at a minimum, because city folk are not like that.
Okay.
They require certain comforts.
Right.
So I'm a complete outdoors person.
Hmm.
I don't really care. I mean,
hmm.
I can go behind a bush or even in front of it.
Right.
For, I, it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
But
when you gotta go, you gotta go.
You gotta go, you gotta go. And when it comes to city folk, there is a little bit of a hesitation.
Yeah,
there
yeah.
is a little bit of a problem. Ki, achha, hygiene kaisa hoga, ye kaisa hoga. I try to convince them ki, arre, 5 minute ka hai toh, you're going to only do it for 5 minutes.
Yeah.
Like, don't spoil the rest of your 24 hours.
Exactly.
At that minutes. So I'll take them out. And around 7, 7.30ish,
yeah.
when it's dark, starts becoming dark rather, I'll give an introduction session.
Mm.
And in that introduction session, I always assume that people who are coming here come with either very little knowledge or zero knowledge.
Right.
Okay. So I start with the very basics.
Right.
What are these stars? What are these constellations? What are the myths? What are the stories? What are the...
So at that time, are they looking at them with naked eye?
Yeah, they're looking at them with naked eyes.
Yeah, no telescope stuff.
No
right?
telescope.
Okay.
Because my belief is that...
No, just hold on because this is really important. I just want to check the juices right now because
okay.
it might go up. Oh yeah, we can hold it off. Yeah, yeah. Let's just... We this part.
Yeah.
Huh. Yeah, cool.
So at this point, they're just looking up.
Hmm.
Okay, and I try to make it a point that... There's always around 35 minutes to 45 minutes with no lights.
Hmm.
So during that time, your pupils sort of grow wider
yeah, yeah.
and you can let more light in.
Right.
Okay. And when that happens, they start seeing, they said, wow, we've never seen so many stars from Mumbai ever.
Hmm.
Okay. And they start understanding what I'm talking about. They start getting it. They start, their
relating.
Own myths
yeah.
are sort of falling down. Their own ideas are sort of getting dismantled.
Right.
And I think everybody needs to have that, to have your own ideas challenged.
Yeah.
It's a big, big
That's
thing.
How you grow.
That's how you grow.
Yeah.
And, you know, then a lot of people come up with these ideas of what, are astrology mein aisa hota, astrology mein aisa hota. And I said, well, astrology is crap.
Yeah.
Okay. So, anything you say about astrology, I will immediately debunk.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay.
Because you have facts too, because I've had people who are like firm believers, but I think it's still a pseudoscience.
I think one philosopher put it very nicely.
Though
he
many
said,
universities are teaching it as science.
They are, but there are also stupid people around the world and people still believe in faith healers. So
yeah.
that's how it,
yeah.
that's how it
yeah.
happens. So I'll just give you an example.
Hmm.
Which is the one constellation that you've always thought of? Or you can recognize, let's say.
The only thing I know when I look at stars is that I can locate north because of, you know, what do you call that? That's
pole star?
Yeah, I'm talking about the direction north.
Yeah,
direction because north. Of the pole star, because of that constellation called
Big Dipper.
The Big Dipper, yeah.
Okay.
So the science mein padha tha, those stars line see the north.
Right, right, right,
yeah,
right.
So that's my thing.
Okay, so there's something very, very nice. It's called pareidolia. Have you heard of it?
Try.
Pareidolia.
No.
I'm not saying if I'm not sure if I'm saying that right.
Because I haven't even heard
okay,
it.
Okay, so it's the idea of seeing things in places. So every time you see at a cloud and you imagine a shape in the cloud.
Okay, what's it called?
Pareidolia.
Okay, all right.
Okay. So it's the human ability to sort of recognize
I
patterns.
Yeah. I guess I'm
okay.
Right.
So when you look up at the stars, you instantly see these patterns.
Hmm.
And when I was a kid, one of my favorite jobs to do was to make constellations.
Right.
I used to make my own constellations.
Huh.
Okay, so ye patterns aap dekh rahe ho, all these patterns that you see, the Big Dipper, Orion, Gemini, everything.
I could never constellation dekhi ki Orion hai lagta tha. Wo pata nahi kyun bana
dete. Once you come to my session, you'll know that.
Matlab ki kahan se wo lag raha hai warrior karke wo.
Haan haan, you'll understand that when you come here. So, but all the stars that you're seeing na,
right.
in the Great Dipper,
yeah,
they are not exactly there.
Okay.
Our human ability to make patterns out of nonsensical things
right.
or things which do not usually are seen there makes these patterns come alive where
okay.
these patterns do not exist. There's no Big Dipper.
Is this because of the distance and the light? Because
no,
the time it takes to reach and it has already moved?
No, not at all.
Okay.
What I mean is, there is let's say 1, 2, 3. There are three dots here.
Right.
Okay. Now those dots don't have anything to do with each other.
Right.
But just because your brain is designed to think in a certain way, you see there's a pattern.
As a constellation. As a constellation. We see them as a constellation.
Okay.
Yeah.
Each one of those stars is light years away from each other.
Right. Right.
They have no connection at all
yeah.
to each other.
Yeah.
To suggest that some star light years away has sort of affected you in some manner is ridiculous.
It's just faith.
It's just faith.
Yeah. No, that's number faith. One. No, faith.
I mean, but then again, you can say the same thing about anything. Faith is not an answer or not a counter to fact.
It's okay. Just, you have to convey a story, you have to tell people, you have to make people believe in something.
Now, all the stories that you've... Now, doesn't it bother you that everywhere you go, they have different... I'll say this. Everywhere you go, there's a different constellation, the different ways people plant out these constellations.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And every single major culture has got astrology.
Right.
Okay. The reason for that is, and one philosopher summed it up very nicely, he said, astrology is the younger sister of astronomy who pays for the upkeep of the older system.
Yeah, makes sense.
Okay. So, everywhere you go, you have these different constellations, you've got these different stories, you've got these different ideas.
Yeah.
Now, how do you figure out which one is right?
Yep. It's the same with God. Yeah.
It's the same with God.
Yeah.
Okay. So whenever I say, you know, I'm an atheist, they say, no, I'm not an atheist. I just believe in one less God than you.
Yeah.
You don't believe in so many,
yeah,
but you believe in one. I just go one step further.
Yeah.
So when you're taking things on faith, everything else goes out the window.
Yep.
Okay. Then you can't.
Especially
science.
And facts. Yeah.
And facts. So when somebody says something like that, when somebody makes a claim, okay. So it's a very nice concept. It's called the burden of proof.
Uh-huh.
Have you heard about it?
I mean, yeah, a lot. It's people relate to it a lot of times. But in what context are you talking about?
So the idea is, if you make a claim,
right?
So the burden is upon you to prove it.
Make people understand.
Okay.
Yeah.
So most people today, even with all the fake news and everything that's coming out, they just shower you with information.
Hmm.
Okay.
Yeah.
And they say, if it's not right, you prove it wrong.
Hmm.
The choice that you're putting on me is a non-starter.
Yeah.
Because if you make the claim that flying donkeys exist,
yeah,
then you must offer evidence to the fact,
right,
that flying donkeys exist.
Yeah.
I cannot go and
that
say that flying
that
donkeys do not exist.
Right. Hmm.
Okay. Because there may be some flying donkey somewhere that I haven't thought of.
Yeah.
Another famous example is the example of a Russell's teapot.
Uh-huh.
Okay, so I was recently debating with one of my friends on Facebook,
right,
and I brought this thing up called the Russell's teapot. He said, I'm suggesting or I'm asserting, okay, that there is a teapot which is filled with tea and is orbiting around the planet Neptune. Okay, so I'll say, there is a teapot there. He said, no, there is, that's absurd. How can you even go to that length? How can you even say that? Acha, prove me wrong then. Now, I will never have the data set to prove, will never have the data set to prove me wrong. Okay. So, I mean, that can be said about anything. I don't understand why people hold faith in such high regard, whereas everything in their life is telling them that evidence-based thinking works, critical thinking works.
If we start talking about that, we'll waste another hour for that. I don't want to do that. But I think it has got something to do with living in a community. It just brings people together.
Maybe.
People like you and me, radical thinkers are on loose, right? Most of them, people will go mad. They'll lose their shit.
No, before they go mad, they'll probably kill us. But
yeah, So yeah, I've come to terms with that. So faith exists. People are sane because of faith. So let them be.
Let them be.
Yeah, let me be me. Let you be yourself.
So once all this is done, all this discussion is done.
Yeah.
So usually we'll have a bonfire session.
Hmm.
And after the bonfire session, there'll be some stories shared from here, there,
yeah,
everywhere.
Yeah.
And we invite the whole group to sort of, share their experiences in life.
Mm-hmm.
In regular. Then we'll have observation session
where
we'll start with whatever is visible at that time.
Uh-huh.
Okay. And some reactions will be superb. I mean, I've seen it a lot. I know the meaning of, when you see something and it takes your breath away.
Yeah.
Because I've seen it happening.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of times when people look through the telescope and they can't speak.
Yeah.
They can't.
I
have to. I have to prod them. Dikha, did you see? And they come up from the eyepiece and they sort of zoned out for like 5 seconds and this.
Yeah.
Haan, dikha. And
yeah.
And then the addiction begins. Like, wow, that was something for you. That was
two
something.
Like space and marine life.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Both
I,
of them.
Yeah.
Of them.
I think. Yeah.
So once they do that, once the telescope session is over, then I usually tell them, sona hai to aap so jao. Then they'll usually be, now it has begun even more that there are a lot of photographers
right
who are coming because
Insta photographers.
No, normal photographers also.
I'm glad.
Normal photographers also. Who come and said, Vikram, teach us how to shoot the night sky, how to make these gorgeous star trails, or how to take that beautiful Milky Way shoot
right.
and everything. So I'll spend some time with them.
Yeah.
And till that time, the rest of these guys are chilling in their tents.
Mm.
And once at around 4 or 5, there is an option for them to wake up.
Okay.
But I don't make an announcement.
Right.
I said anybody wants to sleep who's tired, they can
put an alarm and
get up. Put an alarm and get up yourself.
Okay.
Okay. They come up and then they see, for example, a planet.
Uh-huh.
Or and I always tell this to people. You say, look at Jupiter, look at the moons of Jupiter.
Uh-huh.
Just by doing that, you've joined a very select group of human beings
who
have never seen
it. Yeah, exactly.
Okay, I mean, how awesome is that?
Yeah.
And again, people are taken aback. They're like, wow. So for me, the telescope is an aid to, you know, introducing people to the wonders of the universe.
Right.
It is not the main event.
Hmm.
Okay. So I will usually not go above 4 to 5 objects a night.
Hmm.
Okay. Because you're coming in for the first time, how will you recognize the other smaller, fainter?
You need to absorb it.
You need to absorb
it.
So it's just like with everything. I need to feed you the easy bits first.
Hmm.
Okay.
Yeah.
Once you understand and you appreciate the easy bits, you'll be ready for something much tougher to see. For example, galaxies are very tough to see.
Mm.
Very, very tough to see.
Mm.
Now, they say the closest galaxy to Earth is the Andromeda galaxy.
Yeah.
Okay, which is around 2 million light years.
Mm.
But
you
won't understand it if
you need to say that name again.
The Andromeda galaxy.
How do you spell it?
A-N-D-R-O-M-E-D-A. So, the Andromeda galaxy is around 2 million light years away.
Mm.
It's getting closer.
Yeah.
And you won't figure it out if you don't know what to look for.
Because maybe people have that Milky Way in mind, they are looking for that shape.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But it does not appear to be in that very spiral form. It
exactly.
appears it sort of appears like a faint wisp.
Hmm.
Yeah. That's how it appears. But the size is pretty large. It's almost as large as the moon in
okay.
the night sky.
Okay. The size of the galaxy is as large as
it's as large as the moon in the night
hmm.
sky. So, they don't understand it.
Yeah.
So, and the second thing is, when they look at the Milky Way, you know, we have all these beautiful... Even I post those beautiful pics. Milky
I've seen
Way
the shutter speed wala, star wala, sara that I've
seen.
Yeah.
So, you've
seen
the Milky Way, which is...
Yeah, exactly.
Right
so, pattern.
That is... I don't Photoshop my images.
Right.
Which is to say that I don't add colors to the
mm-hmm.
images. But I enhance the colors which are already there.
Right.
But when you see it, you require a really, really, really dark night where the temperatures are very stable.
Mm.
There's no humidity.
Right.
Then you'll start seeing some of the structures.
Mm.
Otherwise, people start seeing a cloud.
Mm.
Okay. And they can make out it's a cloud. And I've seen this conversation going on in, you know, a couple of my participants a lot of times. They look to each other. Oh, dekhna, wo badal hil nahi rahe. They think they're so udhari. Okay, and then when they come to the realization that, oh boss, ye badal nahi, this is the Milky Way, then their minds are blown, and then there's wow. And once we start taking photos and we start showing it to them that, you know, this is how it looks through long exposure photography, again their mind is blown. So it is something which is really, really, really exciting to them.
Yeah.
And after every trip, the reason I always say that I do not want, the takeaway from this tip is that I do not want you guys to become rocket scientists. I do not want you guys to become astronomers. I want you guys to have a little more appreciation for the night sky than you had yesterday.
Right.
That's all I want. So that more generations can be exposed to it, because the night sky, astronomy, is what, in my opinion, kickstarted civilization.
Hmm.
Understanding the stars, looking at the stars for myths, understanding the seasons,
calendars,
everything.
Yeah.
It started there.
Right.
Okay, that is what helped you from going from a hunter-gatherer to a
civilization
that spans more than 7 billion people
mm.
today. And it is a pity that more people don't get to experience it.
Yeah, and navigation aspect as well.
Navigation.
It just explored, it opened the world. In
it opened the world up.
Yeah.
And today, when I really feel sad when most kids...
Yeah.
From Mumbai, from Pune, from Delhi, from Chennai, or Bengaluru, or anywhere else, don't know how the Milky Way looks like. They only understand or have never seen the Milky Way.
Right.
Or have never seen more than, you know, let's say 30 stars in the sky.
Hmm.
You should look at them. They become zapped when they come outside.
Hmm.
Okay. And I just want this to keep going.
Right.
I just want more people to understand. I just want more people to get into the sciences. I'm very happy if somebody decides to choose a career in science because of me. That would
mm-hmm.
be a big achievement.
Yeah.
That I think that somebody
that goes
really into
cool.
science.
Yeah.
Rather than and one more thing. My BSc, which by the way I never really completed. I'm the only person who's still doing science.
Yeah.
everybody else is either in marketing or in finance or in something.
I know what you're trying to say.
Yeah. So why did you do it then?
Yeah, exactly. You chose your stream.
You
very
chose your stream. And they said, ki, Vikram, you know, all this is bakwas. Paisa to chahiye na. Okay. And this is the third point that I sent you in the email. This constant need for people to be successful.
Yeah,
that if you're not successful, if you're not doing this by a certain age, or if you're not owning this house by a certain age, or this car by a certain age, or if your lifestyle is not this by a certain age, you are somehow wrong, or somehow
you won't be accepted.
You won't be accepted.
Yeah.
You won't be accepted. And I've seen a lot of this happening, especially with people. I won't go to the extreme and say that on the fringe of society, but even those who live within it,
right?
They have expected everything under the sun. You should have this, you should have that, you should have this, you should have that. Tumhari six-figure ki salary honi chahiye, tumhari ye gaadi honi chahiye, tumhare paas itna bank balance hona chahiye. You should work in, software company,
multinational corporations.
Yeah, corporation. To do what? To do what?
They need people, man. That's how we get our social media and everything. You need people over there. I think it's a balance. So there are people who need to do stuff like what you are doing. If you aren't there, if people like you aren't there, who are not like, so let's say artists, writers, I wouldn't hesitate to say that we are a different breed. And if people like us weren't there, who were providing entertainment or knowledge in any form, right? There won't be any escape for people.
There isn't.
Yeah, and
there
if they weren't there, then we are just doing it for ourselves, which is also counterproductive in a way. Need audience.
I'm saying that you should do it.
Yeah.
I'm saying you should do it, but you should not do it because somebody is telling you to do it or somebody is pressuring
you. That makes
you
sense. Yeah, that makes sense.
Okay, I know a lot of very happy office going folk.
Yeah.
They are in love with their jobs.
They like 9-to-5.
They like 9-to-5. Yeah. It gives them stability.
Yeah.
It gives them everything. So when it comes to stability, I say, fuck stable. I mean, why don't you settle down? So main doodh nahi jiske andar dahi dalo uska settle ho jayega main. Okay, I am who I am. I am drawing an immense amount of happiness from where I am in my life.
Exactly.
I have worked harder than you have ever worked hard in your office. Okay, I have brought, for example, stargazing, or people at least know it's out there now.
It's a gamble and it's very difficult.
It's a gamble, it's very difficult.
Very difficult.
And
it takes courage to do
every day.
Yeah, it takes courage.
Yeah. When people say, when you start a business, a lot of people say, why do you want to start? Well, there's boss nahi rahega yaar sir pe.
Yeah, exactly.
They don't realize that once you enter into a business, everybody is your boss. Every single customer that you serve is your boss. And you have to cater to that person.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. And once you do that, if you're happy with doing that, I think you'll be happy in 15,000 rupees also. I think you'll be sad at 5 lakh.
Absolutely.
Rupees.
Absolutely.
Okay.
It makes sense.
So for me,
unless you are under the pressure that you have to maintain the way you said, right?
You have
okay.
to maintain.
Ye hona chahiye, ye gaadi honi chahiye, ye bike hona chahiye, ye ghar hona chahiye, aisa hona chahiye. But yeah. And I feel sad for the people who love 9-to-5, who love jobs, good on you.
It's good on you.
It's perfect. But who are struggling and who andar hi andar bahar se batayenge theek hai, but andar hi andar who are like that, what the hell am I doing? Shit, shaadi ho gayi, shit, bachche ho gaye, ab main kya karun?
Now they're locked in.
Exactly.
Then now you can't do it.
Responsibilities. And then if you fuck up, then you are actually irresponsible because now you actually have a family.
Yeah, you voted for those things in your life.
Exactly. Exactly.
Right? So when you came up, you said yes to this, and you have to bear the consequences of those things.
Right.
So I am very happy being, not earning as much as my peers do, which is not to say that I make paltry sums of money.
That is not a measure of success.
That is not a measure of success. And I don't think we should be valuing success only in terms of monetary terms. I think small goals make you a much better and happier person than these very long
term. Everyone either knows it already or they realize it eventually. Eventually they
maybe,
do.
Maybe.
They do. Some people are misguided or whatever. Anyway, bro, I think it was fun, man. I really wanted a writer to, come to the show, and I'm glad that, you came up with
came
space.
Up. Yeah.
Yeah, with space. It was fun, man. Good luck to you with Beyond Earth.
Thank you. Good luck to you as well with this podcast.
Oh, thanks, man. Thanks, Vikram. Thank you for doing this. Thanks.